السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, most gracious, most merciful. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. All praise is indeed due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator, nourisher, sustainer, provider, protector, curer of one and all. Wassalatu wassalamu ala ashrafil anbiya'i wal mursaleen, nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his household, his companions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them all. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us his companionship in the akhirah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless our offspring as well and grant us all Jannatul Firdaus together with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My brothers and sisters, if you were to look at social media, you would find that over the last few years, there are certain platforms that have grown, and these platforms have made it easy for people to keep in touch. Unfortunately, the terms used when keeping in touch with someone are not necessarily accurate. I give you an example. When you want to know what someone is doing on Twitter, for example, you have to click, you have to press a button. That button would then tell you that you are following them. I'm sure you've come across that. So it will tell you you have so many followers and you are following so many people. You and I know that we don't necessarily follow them. We just want to know what they're doing. So the following means two or three different things. To some people, it's just like being nosy. You want to know everything they do, so you're following them. Some people want to be inspired by the person they are following, so they take from them. And this is why you find people's lives change when they follow the right people. However, for some, they will even tell you that I will only retweet what I find interesting from those whom I follow. And when I retweet something, it does not mean that I endorse it. This is what they make quite clear. So you find the young people following thousands of people and thousands are following them. But that doesn't mean whatever they say is done. It doesn't mean they look up to them. Sometimes you follow a person because you don't like them and you want to know what they're doing. That's quite nosy, but that's what happens. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Why do I say this? Because my brothers and sisters, we have sometimes reduced the statement follower of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to whenever it suits us. That's what we've done. So we begin to abuse the term following all the way to the following of Allah and His Rasul. I say I'm a follower of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is in no ways equivalent or even close to the following that one may be doing in terms of social media. But sadly, it's become that, where we take what suits us and we leave what doesn't. So if I were to tell you, my brother, this is in the Quran, this is in the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is the instruction of Allah, this is the instruction of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if I'm a true follower, I would make it my business to try my best to be real in what I've claimed. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about this in Surah An-Nur, which is the 24th surah of the Quran, verse number 48. What does he talk about? He speaks about the disputes that we have amongst ourselves. So as human beings, it's only normal that I might have a problem with you, you might have a difficulty with me, perhaps a misunderstanding that might stem to the need of arbitration, the need of judgment in our matter. So for example, if I have a misunderstanding with you, it happens to be about money. What will happen is, if we cannot resolve it between the two of us, we might need a third party to help us. That third party would either make a decision based on what Allah has revealed through Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the instruction of Allah and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or he might decide to choose a different method. If he chooses a different method, then how can we call ourselves believers in Allah and his Messenger when we are not even prepared to use their solutions and to take their instructions as instructions and their prohibitions as prohibitions? This is something quite clear. So Allah says, there are some people whom, when they are called towards the solution of Allah or the judgment of Allah and His Messenger, they turn away because it doesn't suit them. They say, no, I'm not really interested. But are you a Muslim? Yes, I'm a Muslim, but seasonal. For this moment, it doesn't suit me. And Allah says, if it is theirs for a moment, they quickly come back. Hey, that 500,000 rands is mine, because you know what Allah says? You know what the hadith says? You know what Sharia says, etc., etc.? Now it suits you, so suddenly, there you are. Allah knows that there will be people existing who alternate and who shift from pillar to post every now and again. Whenever it suits them, they do this. When it doesn't, they do the other one. So Allah says, regarding the hypocrites, verse number 48, Surah An-Nur.
وَإِذَا دُعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ لِيَحْكُمَ بَيْنَهُمْ إِذَا فَرِيقٌ مِّنْهُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ وَإِن يَكُنْ لَهُمُ الْحَقُّ يَأْتُوا إِلَيْهِ مُذْعِنِينَ.
When they are called to the judgment of Allah and His Rasul, you find a group from among them dispersing, running away. They turn away. Yet, if the right was theirs and they were gaining by that, they would quickly come back and say, no, I want it the way Allah has decided. That's what Allah says in the Quran. So Allah says, is there a disease in their hearts? Definitely the believers. The very next verse, Allah says, in fact, verse number 51.
إِنَّمَا كَانَ قَوْلَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذَا دُعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ لِيَحْكُمَ بَيْنَهُمْ أَنْ يَقُولُوا سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا.
Indeed, the true believers, the real followers, those who follow to the letter, to the T, when they are called to the judgment of Allah and His Rasul, in their dispute, they are the first to say, سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. We have heard and we have obeyed. That's it. They realize that no matter what, you are in a win-win situation. Because if that was Allah's decision, that's it. It's going to be my way. And if that was against Allah's decision, it's not going to be my way. And if I have lost materially because I followed what Allah said, I know that all that material item belongs to Allah. He will recompensate me and He will actually ensure that I achieve a reward in the hereafter. So we've saved ourselves from the calamity of this world and we've saved ourselves from the disaster of the hereafter. Remember, there was once a person who disputed or who was disputing just outside the doorstep of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. سَمِعَ جَلَبَةَ خَصْمٍ بِبَابِ حُجْرَتِهِ فَخَرَجَ فَقَالَ. It's a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He heard a dispute of people who were arguing outside his door. He came out. He saw what was happening. He made a statement. Because obviously he was told to judge. He says, look, I will judge on that which is apparent. If any one of you is taking the right of your brother knowingly, then you should know, even if the judgment has been passed in your favor and in your heart you know it was not yours, you have taken a red hot coal from the red hot coals of the fire of hell. You can either take it or leave it. It's up to you. So when you have gone to whoever you wanted to choose to arbitrate, number one, you could have compromised your faith. Number two is you could be judged for, yet it was against you. I hope you understand this. It's up to us to realize, you want to save yourself? Better be honest. Let's rather give things up than to actually take that which is not ours. It is reported in one narration that in that particular dispute, both parties decided to leave the thing that they were arguing about. One says, brother, it's yours. The other one says, no, brother, it's yours. They left it there and they went away because they knew that, you know what, we're really confused here. Rather leave it and both of us will be saved in the akhirah. Imagine taking a cent that doesn't belong to you. What would happen in the hereafter? In this world, you might enjoy it for a moment. People rob each other of millions of rands and dollars. They enjoy it for a while in the moment. My brother, my sister, what will happen in the hereafter when that is multiplied and brought onto your shoulders? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never let that happen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never let that happen. And this is why, if someone knowingly goes against the instruction of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he won't be able to save himself. Listen to verse number 63, the last verse of Surah An-Nur. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
فليحذر الذين يخالفون عن أمره أن تصيبهم فتنة أو يصيبهم عذاب أليم.
Give a warning to those who go against his instruction. Whose instruction? The instruction of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that they will be tested very severely, al-fitna, or they will be punished in a very painful way. Wow. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. And this is why we say, you want to be saved from the calamities of this world and the next? Engage in repentance. Seek a lot of forgiveness. Look into yourself. Remember, this worldly life is very short. The winner is he who actually gets the book in the right hand on the day of judgment and is told, for you is Jannah. That is a true winner. In this world, we may not know such people. This is why we always say, on earth, there are some really famous people, but they are not famous in the heavens. And on earth, there are some people whom nobody knows, but they are so famous in the skies, they are really superstars when it comes to the heavens. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us Jannatul Firdaus. Let's move on to the next surah. Suratul Furqan. It is the criterion, the distinguishing factor between right and wrong, between good and bad, between evil and goodness, the distinguishing factor. Suratul Furqan speaks a lot about the impact of your company. The people you have around you, they change your thinking. They close your brain sometimes. They open up your thoughts sometimes. They open up your thinking sometimes. So who is around you, who you allow yourself to interact with, they play a huge role in the type of person you become. Remember this. I, as a counselor for the last 17, 18 years, I can tell you that a lot of people who have bad habits, they have collected them from their friends. A lot of those who smoke, their friends smoke. A lot of those on drugs, their friends are on drugs. The people they mix with have those habits, so they develop the same habits without realizing. So Suratul Furqan, there is a lot that is spoken in it about the company you keep and different angles of the impact that it has. Let's start off. Point number one. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about how there are some people who worship idols. Some people worship deities and gods besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah says, don't they think for a moment? What should they think about? Listen to verse number three.
وَاتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِهِ آلِهَةً لَا يَخْلُقُونَ شَيْئًا وَهُمْ يُخْلَقُونَ وَلَا يَمْلِكُونَ لِأَنفُسِهِمْ ضَرًّا وَلَا نَفْعًا وَلَا يَمْلِكُونَ مَوْتًا وَلَا حَيَاةً وَلَا نُشُورًا.
Allah says they have taken as gods besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala those who cannot do any harm, nor can they do any good, neither for themselves nor for those who worship them. Imagine a person worshipping a stone. If a person is worshipping a stone, can they not ask themselves a question? What does the stone do? Can it harm itself or protect itself from harm or benefit itself? If not, how will it benefit or protect or grant goodness to that which is besides it? It's a question that Allah says you should ask yourself and you will be able to answer it. Then Allah says, ضَرًّا وَلَا نَفْعًا. And then Allah says, مَوْتًا وَلَا حَيَاتًا. They worship that which does not control death, nor does it control life. وَلَا حَيَاتًا وَلَا نُشُورًا. It does not control the resurrection. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the goodness and the evil. This thing doesn't control anything. How can you worship deities besides Allah? You worship Allah alone. But sometimes because of the company, because of how we've been brought up, we don't even realize it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling us to ask ourselves the question. And this is the type of question we will find in verse number three of Suratul Furqan. Immediately after that, Allah makes mention of how some people, again to do with your company, at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is made mention of how some of the companions earlier on, prior to the advent of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they used to create idols out of foodstuff sometimes. And when they were hungry, guess what happened? They began to consume the same God that didn't give them food. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a deep understanding. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those who worship Him alone. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when we brought the goodness to them, they began to find fault in the messenger, in the Quran, and in so many other aspects, because they had no answer. You see, when you have no answer for someone, what's the quickest way out? Just find fault in him. Just say, for example, that you know what, this person is evil, this person is bad, so that no one has to listen to him or her. No one has to actually think about what they are doing themselves. Is it right or wrong? That's what they did at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Listen to some of the confusions that they tried to create regarding the Quran. Verse number 4, Surah Al-Furqan, Allah says,
وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا إِنْ هَذَا إِلَّا إِفْكٌ افْتَرَاهُ وَأَعَانَهُ عَلَيْهِ قَوْمٌ آخَرُونَ.
The kuffar at the time, they said that this Quran is a fabrication that was created by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and some other people have helped him to do this, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, having had the help of all the eloquent people, brought up something that was linguistically absolutely magnificent, totally perfect. They could not believe that he brought it. So because they didn't want to listen to it, they found fault. Now this is a fabrication. This is a lie. Now remember, in Surah An-Nur, there was a rumor being spread about someone that was negative. We are taught to say that which is negative, it's a lie. It's about someone. It's about his dignity. It is about the respect and reputation of a person. There's no need to believe it. But when it comes to what you are doing yourself, at least ask yourself, am I involved in this? If I am, I'm going to do something about it. Because I don't want to just find fault in the messenger just because I don't like the message. No, sometimes we have to change our lives. I've spoken to so many people who've reverted to Islam, and they say to come out of that comfort zone and enter the fold of what is right is absolutely difficult, because sometimes you lose your family members. You lose so many. You embrace Islam, they look at you as a spy sometimes, and they don't even want to mix and interact with you. You cannot even get married because they look at you with an eye of suspicion. So how difficult it must be for those who revert to Islam. This is why I spend a moment to say, my brothers, my sisters, those who've reverted to Islam, against all odds, learn to embrace them. Learn to understand they are your brothers and sisters who have made a decision that is perhaps the most difficult decision, and definitely the most important decision, not only in their lives, but regarding their hereafter as well. So let's embrace them. Let's make it easy for them. Let's educate them. Let's help them. Let's try and bring them within. If they would like to get married and they are both parties happy, facilitate it for them. I know of families, and it's very sad to say this, but it's important. It's the correct platform to say it. I know of families whereby the boy and girl want to get married, but because one of them is a revert, they say, no, revert. Brother, a revert is cleaner than you, who was a born Muslim. Because when he accepted Islam, he started a new slate at the age of 25, 30. Yours is dirty from the time you started all your business. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. So what's wrong? Let's not be racist. Let's not be people who look at others with the eye of suspicion. For what? If they have reverted to Islam, for as long as they've proven that they are decent Muslimin, alhamdulillah, إِذَا أَتَاكُم مَّن تَرْضَوْنَ دِينَهُ وَخُلُقَهُ فَزَوِّجُوهُ. Here is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We are not just mere Twitter followers. No, we follow him correctly. When he says, when someone proposes for your child and the level of their deen is good and their level of character is good, let it happen. If you don't let it happen, there's going to be fitna. There's going to be chaos. There's going to be facade on earth. In your little life, your family will turn upside down. Why? You blocked something that the messenger instructed you not to block. That's where the problem is. We are guilty of this. In our societies, as much as we say we're not racist, sadly, it raises its ugly head now and again. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. Take a look at the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Who was better? We or them? They were far better. They were all reverts, by the way. Allahu Akbar. All of them. So congratulations to those who've reverted here on their own accord. You have joined the ranks of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum in one aspect of your living and in one aspect of your deen. That's a tough one. Which means if a Sahabi had to come and ask for your daughter, what would you say? Revert. I don't want to go as far as that, but I could have, in order to make you think. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help those young boys and girls suffering at the hands of their own parents, because their parents are being ridiculous. They don't realize what's going on behind the scenes, and they just want to stick up to their pride. What will people say? My brother, what will Allah say? What will the messenger say? What type of an embarrassment are you going to be for yourself on the day of judgment when you have encouraged sin and you have discouraged that which was halal just because you had an arrogance? What will my family say? Your family is not worried about you. You lead the way, my brother, my sister, lead the way. They will follow you. They also have children in the same boat. Each one is saying, what will our family say? If you led the way, they'll say, mashallah, you know, we've been struggling for the last 2 years in the same way. Now that we saw what you did, we're going to do the same. Subhanallah, you led the way. You lead the way to Jannah as well. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us Jannatul Firdaus. So they found fault with what? They tried to find fault with the Quran by saying, this is a fabrication. It's a tale of a long time back. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, no way, that's not the case. Here's another of the rumors that they spread.
وَقَالُوا أَسَاطِيرُ الْأَوَّلِينَ اكْتَتَبَهَا فَهِيَ تُمْلَى عَلَيْهِ بُكْرَةً وَأَصِيلًا.
They said that these verses are copied from the previous nations, from others before them. These verses are copied and they are being dictated morning and night to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He's just coming and repeating them. Why were they saying this? Some of what is in the Quran is clarification of what has appeared in the previous scriptures. The reason is they are from the same source. But it's not exactly the same story. It is a clarification, and sometimes the detail is so much that they have learned from us. I give you one example. The mention of Isa alayhi salam, or Jesus may peace be upon him, there is a great clarification in the Quran. There is a whole surah known as Surah Maryam. There is a surah which we read in Taraweeh yesterday, a few days back. Ali Imran, the family of Imran. Mention is made of Mary, the Virgin Mary, may peace be upon her. Isa, Jesus, may peace be upon him. There is a miracle that is not found in the Bible. What is it? That he spoke from the cradle. They don't have that in the Bible. So the Quran says he spoke from the cradle to clear and clarify the name of his mother. He says, Inni Abdullah, I am the worshipper of Allah. Wow, that's a miracle. The Christians are amazed by how the Quran speaks of the miracles of Jesus, may peace be upon him. But that requires one with an open mind to actually look into and to come and study, and they will realize the respect that the Muslims have for Jesus, may peace be upon him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, verse number 6, clarifying and clearing these rumors. Allah says,
قُلْ أَنزَلَهُ الَّذِي يَعْلَمُ السِّرَّ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا.
Amazing. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell them that it is he who knows the secrets of the heavens and the earth who has revealed this Quran. Therefore, you will find all the secrets of the earth and the heavens in the particular book that is Allah's book, the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why verse number 32, I'm just fast forwarding, the same surah, Surah Furqan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of another issue that was raised by the kuffar of Mecca in order to try and find fault in the Quran. You know what they said? Now, I'm sure all of us have heard that the Quran was not revealed all at once, unlike the previous books. The Quran was revealed over a period of 23 years. Why? You're allowed to ask why, because obviously we want to know. The reason is the Quran was unique. It came down with every incident that occurred. They were verses that clarified it so that people could remember. And so that, you know, if there was an incident in your life and you remember what someone said on that occasion, it's far easier than me reciting to you all the rules and regulations, and now you've just got to know them without knowing what happened, when it happened. If I were to tell you, you know, 4 years ago we met and there was a car accident and there was a policeman who came, do you remember what he did? You're going to say, yes, I do. I remember what he did, because it was an incident. It's far easier for your heart to accept, to digest, to practice practice upon, because practically it happened in front of you and you saw how they practiced upon it. That's one of the reasons why it was spread over 23 whole years. Also, another reason was the people were not prepared to accept the message. So Allah decided subhanahu wa ta'ala to reveal it in doses. There are different types of verses that were revealed in Makkah, different types of verses revealed in Medina. Al-Munawwara. In Makkatul Mukarrama, the verses were short and sharp, connected to belief, connected to the hereafter, because they never believed in the hereafter. But in Medina Munawwara, longer verses with rules and regulations. They were now Muslimin. They were now ready to take the rules of Salah and Zakah. This is why a lot of these pillars were actually made compulsory in Medina Munawwara. Salah was farad in Medina Munawwara, although it was revealed earlier, but it was not compulsory. It was voluntary. Then it became compulsory. The same applies to zakah. The same applies to hajj, etc. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an understanding. So the kuffar said, وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَوْلَا نُزِّلَ عَلَيْهِ الْقُرْآنُ جُمْلَةً وَاحِدَةً. Why did this Quran not come down all at once? Allah says, كَذَلِكَ لِنُثَبِّتَ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ وَرَتَّلْنَاهُ تَرْتِيلًا. Amazing. Allah says, in this way, the way we've revealed it, it's to strengthen your heart in a way that subhanAllah, you recite it beautifully, melodiously, like I explained earlier, reasons of revelation and so many other factors that are taken into consideration. So this was a clarification by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala regarding the Quran. And that is why to this day, the Quran, no one can compete with. Not at all. Allah says right at the beginning, he describes the Quran, Surah Al-Baqarah. ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين. There is no doubt in this book. No doubt. In it, there is guidance for those who are muttaqeen. Who are the muttaqeen? Those who are conscious of their maker. If you're conscious of your maker, you will achieve guidance from the Quran. If you're not conscious of your maker, forget about achieving guidance from the Quran. You can only achieve guidance if you're conscious of Allah. If not, you will be irritated, astaghfirullah, by that, because you don't believe at all. A person needs to believe, conviction. You want to develop a connection with Allah. Here's the book. Go and compare it with all other heavenly books. Wallahi, it stands out. It is the only book to this day that has been memorized by billions. Billions over time. Maybe it might go into trillions and quadrillions if we were to count over time. You might argue there's only 6-7 billion on earth today. I'm not talking about today. I'm talking about over the last 1400 years. There were billions. Today, subhanAllah, I've received messages from Sierra Leone telling me about the Quran competition they have there that almost encompasses the entire country. Subhanallah. Everyone is abuzz. Why? The Quran. Look at all of us. Every one of us has a relationship with the Quran. We've been reading. Am I right? I hope so. We've been listening. We come to Taraweeh. We enjoy a beautiful recital, wallahi, for the sake of Allah. When the recital is beautiful and clear, you feel like you're engaged in an act of worship, not in a war. Like I say, you know, when I was a little bit younger, we used to go into some masajid. You enter the masjid, it's like you in a war zone. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Sami Allah, Allah. Hey, what's going on here? Relax. I'm not in a war. This is an act of worship. It's supposed to be calm, cool, relaxing. And you're supposed to enjoy it. This is what the Quran is all about. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about this beautiful book. Now I want to go into some of the comments they uttered against Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I want to start off mentioning one and we'll continue tomorrow. Who was Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He was not ordinary. He was the best of creation, the most noble of all messengers of Allah. How do I know that? Allah chose him and Allah chooses. Allah raises some above the other. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was raised above all, subhanallah. This is why we believe that when we follow him, it's not just a following like, you know, retweets are not endorsements. No, retweet everything and everything is endorsed and we shall endeavor to follow, subhanallah. But we have the correct understanding. So we need to know this. So they just said, he's mad. Astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. Someone is telling you something, you just say he's mad. Who's mad here?
وَقَالَ الظَّالِمُونَ إِن يتبعون إلا رجلا مسحورا.
The oppressors from among them, they said, you people are following a person who is bewitched. He's bewitched. He's mental. A'udhu billah. I don't even want to say what they said. Had it not been mentioned in the Quran, the term mashur means bewitched. He doesn't know what he's doing or saying. Astaghfirullah. And Allah says,
انظر كيف ضربوا لك الأمثال فضلوا.
Look at how they are giving bad examples about you. They are gone astray. They are gone astray as a result of these evil words they are uttering. Had they kept quiet and listened to what he was saying, they would have digested it, understood it. Their lives would have changed. There were two types of people. One, those who looked at Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam with the eye of understanding and genuineness. They became known as Sahaba. They were the best of those who tread the earth after the prophets. And there were others in his presence who looked at him with the eye of enmity. They never learned a thing from him. In fact, he will bear witness against them on the day of judgment, yet they were in his presence. How unfortunate. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. Inshallah, we will continue tomorrow. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallah bihamdihi, subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.